While believers contended with periodic outbursts of persecution in Roman-controlled territory, another threat was aberrant sects that kept rising up, aiming to hijack the faith, as the church father Origen had foreseen, prompting, of course, his prodigious supply of materials to help inoculate the church against error. Now, it's understandable why those early centuries saw the heretical and aberrant movements that we've already considered, Montanism, Marcionism, and the Gnostics. You see, precisely what Christians believed, that was still being hammered out. It was the threat posed by false teachers that forced church leaders to formalize precisely what it was that Christians did believe. Just as today, some new wind of doctrine will blow through the church. Most Christians have little idea what's wrong with it. They just sense something is. It doesn't sound or it doesn't feel right. They couldn't say precisely what that is. It takes some astute pastor, Bible scholar, or maybe a theologian to show how that idea is contrary to Scripture. And then everyone's clued in and has an idea of why and how to that thing is off. Now, multiply that process by decades and centuries, and you can see how a large and detailed body of Christian theology developed. Usually, church leaders turn to the Bible to compare the new idea to what was already known to be God's word and will. But sometimes what was needed were new words, or to make sure that everyone was pouring the same meaning into the words that were being used. And we see how important this is today when we're dealing with the cults. You see, two people can say they're Christians and both believe in and follow Jesus, but while one person's Jesus is the eternal Son of God, conceived by the Holy Spirit in the womb of a virgin Jewish teenager named Mary, the other person's Jesus is a manifestation of the archangel Michael, or the mere human son of a god named Elohim, who used to be a man on another planet long ago, but who ascended into being a god with a heavenly harem by which he produced spirits looking for human bodies. Hey, both of those Jesuses are precisely what two of the more prominent cults claim today. My point is, we need to make sure that we're pouring the same meaning into the words that we use, especially when we're doing theology, because what we believe about God is the most important thing about us. Our vocabulary must sync up with our dictionary. We'll see how complex and what a major deal all of that was when we get to the debates about the Trinity and the nature of Jesus in the 4th and the 5th centuries. For now, realize that even earlier, during the later 1st through 3rd centuries, it was usually pastors who did most of the theological work as they dealt with the challenge of false teaching about God and Jesus, confronting the people that they led. Well, we turn now to consider some of the major doctrinal challenges and groups that challenged the early church. And again, we've already looked at the Montanists, Marcionism, and the greatest challenge to the church in the early centuries, Gnosticism. But another group that caused problems was a kind of, well, almost anti-Marcionist sect called the Ebionites. They emerged toward the end of the first century and continued into the fourth. Their beliefs smacked of the error the Apostle Paul dealt with in his epistle to the churches of Galatia. Ebionites said that Jesus wasn't the eternal Son of God. He was just a successor to Moses, whose mission was to enforce a strict legalism. They claimed that Jesus was a Jew who knew and kept the law perfectly. And because he did, at his baptism, the Spirit of God descended on him, empowering him to be a prophet, not far, of course, from what the Gnostics had said. Ebionites were ascetics who avoided all forms of pleasure, assuming that if it was pleasurable, it had to be wrong. They practiced poverty, ultra forms of self-denial, and elaborate religious rituals. Their name, Ebionites, comes from a Hebrew word meaning poor. They likely took this name to honor their founder, Ebion, who spurned his given name in favor of the title, the Poor One. Now, what little we know of the Ebionites comes from accounts by their opponents. The first Christian to write about them was Irenaeus, who mentions them in his work Against Heresies. Origen also refers to them, echoing Irenaeus' assessment of them. Ebionites rejected the New Testament in favor of a scroll known as the Gospel according to the Hebrews. Keeping the Jewish flavor of their origins, they met in synagogues. They didn't call them churches. They considered the Apostle Paul, with his emphasis on salvation by grace through faith, a dangerous heretic. For Ebionites, Jesus wasn't the Savior. Moses was. because he had given the law. Jesus was just a, well, kind of Solomon-like figure who proved that people could obey the law. When the Roman general Titus laid siege to Jerusalem, the Ebionites joined forces with the Gnostics. A close reading of Paul's letter to the Colossians gives a hint that it was this Gnostic Ebionism that was troubling the church there. Now, another group that presented a challenge to the early church were the Manichaeists. In some ways, they were, I guess, theological cousins of Gnosticism. You see, like the Gnostics, they were dualist, regarding the spiritual realm to be unalterably good, while the material, physical world was hopelessly corrupt. Their founder was the 3rd century mystic Mani, who gave the movement its name, Manichaeism. He proposed two opposing forces, light and darkness, forever locked in an eternal combat. Salvation was defined as the victorious struggle of the children of light overcoming darkness by a life of self-denial and celibacy. Now, if you're a student of world religions, and that sounds a lot like Zoroastrianism of Persia, give yourself a gold star because you know where it came from. Mani was a Parthian who grew up in a nominally Christian home. He was loath to give up the ancient Zoroastrianism of his homeland, and so he decided to mix the two. Once he'd begun, he decided to go ahead and, well, add a dash of Buddhism, Hinduism, and a sprinkling of Judaism. Mani's religion was an ancient version of Baha'i. You know, just snag whatever seems most appealing from a handful of major religions, toss it all in a bowl, mix it thoroughly, cook at 350 degrees for 20 minutes, let it cool, and serve with a cup of Kool-Aid. It's not hard to understand why Manichaeism appealed to so many people at that time. The Romans had brought dozens of different people under one political and economic system. Since religion was a crucial part of people's lives, the diversity of faiths was a potential stress point that could lead to conflict. So, a religion that appealed to everyone because it contained a little bit of them seemed like a good move. We look now at another significant church leader, Clement of Alexandria. Born Titus Flavius Clement, he was born in Athens to pagan parents in 160. Now, Clement presents a relatively small group of educated and cultured converts to Christianity in the late 2nd century. His search for truth took him around the Mediterranean, but it ended in Alexandria when he heard a Christian scholar and preacher named Pantanus explain the gospel in a manner that appealed to his search for philosophical truth. Clement became a convert who couldn't learn the lessons of faith fast enough. He was soon made an elder in the Alexandrian church. When Pantanus retired in 190, Clement succeeded him as head of the school, the same school that Origen would later take over. Now that school, while run by Christians and dedicated to the faith, was anything but a narrow-minded thought factory spitting out lockstep followers of Jesus. The school reflected the cultural mixture of Alexandria. It welcomed Christians, pagans, and Jews who wanted the best education available. The directors of the school believed that the Christian faith, given a fair hearing, would prevail over other ideas. Among others, the non-Christian philosopher Ammonius Saccas taught there. Origen was a student, as was Plotinus, founder of what would become the immensely influential philosophy of Neoplatonism. Now, Alexandria was one of the largest and most influential cities of the entire Roman Empire. It was the Oxford and Cambridge of its day, with numerous schools and academies filled with students from literally all over the Roman world, who were sent there by wealthy parents because schooling in Alexandria, well, was considered a necessity for the nobility and anyone who aspired to the nobility. The city's museum, that is, its temple to the muses, along with its nearby library, was the forerunner of the modern university, where scholars from various fields met to discuss and exchange ideas. Being at the mouth of the Nile, Alexandria was also a major center of trade to which ideas from all over the world came, fermented in the fertile intellectual soil of the city, and then went out to influence thinkers far and wide. Most early church fathers were pastors who developed the theological framework of the church while going about their daily duties of leading a congregation. Clement and Origen were the exceptions to that. You see, rather than leading a church, they were what we might call professors, teaching students in the Alexandrian school. Clement's goal was to assist those who, like himself in his youth, were seekers after truth. He aimed to convince pagan intellectuals that Christianity was not the bizarre superstition that many of them at that time assumed. Most of Clement's written works were aimed at pagans. He followed the example of the Alexandrian Jewish scholar Philo, who used Greek philosophy to interpret the Old Testament. I once again want to pause to define a term used frequently in this period of church history, and that's the term pagan. In today's parlance, pagan is most often a put-down. It's a way to label someone as rude, crude, immoral. But that's not what we mean when we refer to people as pagan in the context of this period of history. I use it in its classic sense. Pagans were those who attributed the forces of nature to the activity of a pantheon of gods and goddesses. Pagans worshipped the Greek and Roman gods that formed the cadre of characters of the myths of the classical era. It was these pagans that Clement addressed, reasoning with them about why they ought to put their trust in Christ. In his exhortation to the Greeks, or in some versions to the Gentiles, and then in other versions to the pagans, he made a defense of the Christian faith from Greek philosophy and literature. By cherry-picking quotes, he showed an ascending revelation upward through poets, philosophers, and pagan oracles, Hebrew prophets, and then to the highest revelation of all in Christ. In the exhortation, Clement leaned heavily on Plato to set forth an objective, absolute truth. Now, since it's the nature of truth to be true, it must ultimately originate in a single source, which Clement located in Jesus and Scripture. In seeking to bridge the historical and intellectual divide between Greeks and Jews, Clement said that God had given the Greeks philosophy and the Jews the law. Both lead to the truth and are unified in Christ. Philosophers and prophets were spiritual cousins. And Clement was eager to connect faith and reason. He made a convincing argument that one cannot function without the other. Reason, he said, begins with presuppositions that can't be proven. They're taken by faith. Therefore, the ultimate first principle is faith, on which reason builds. But those who are content to take all things on faith that fails to issue into reason, they're like children forever content with milk. His work titled The Instructor was the first Christian treatise on ethics and speaks of Jesus Christ as the supreme revelation of how people ought to believe. But maybe Clement's most important work was titled Miscellanies. As the title suggests, Clement said that the seeker has to go through a patchwork of ideas to get to the truth, like winnowing wheat through a sieve. He called philosophy a schoolmaster to bring the Greek thinker to Christ. He believed God used philosophy to lead pre-Christian Gentiles to a knowledge of the truth of Christ. Although the teaching of Christ was complete in itself, philosophy served Clement as a kind of wall for the vineyard, he called it, to defend the truth of Christianity. Now, what's of interest to us about Clement of Alexandria is the impact that he had on Origen, who we've already looked at. It was his ready use of philosophy, an allegorical style of interpreting scripture, that had a far-reaching consequence in the early and medieval church. Now, a letter was discovered in Jerusalem in 1958 claiming Clement as the author. It was written to someone named Theodore and speaks of a secret Gospel of Mark with a couple of quotations from it. The genuineness of the letter's authorship by Clement is generally accepted, though it's not clear if he was endorsing the work as legitimate or merely using some useful quotes from it. Clement seems to think that Mark wrote two Gospels, but the so-called secret Gospel of Mark bears strong evidence of Gnostic origin. The manuscript isn't complete, so we're not sure what Clement's final word on the issue was. While hymns have been in use in church services well before Clement, their authorship is unknown. He's the first hymn writer that we do know of. The hymn that we do know that was attributed to him was translated in 1831 by Lowell Mason under the title Shepherd of Tender Youth. Now, Clement fled Alexandria during the persecution by the Roman Emperor Septimius Severus in 202 and died in Asia Minor. The life and work of Clement of Alexandria sets before us an important question, and one that has a long discussion among Christians of the first couple of centuries. It was over what influences should be allowed to shape the Christian faith. It finds expression in the challenge that was posed by the church father Tertullian, and is stated this way: what has Athens to do with Jerusalem? Historians spend considerable time on this period of intellectual development for the Christian faith. In an attempt to simplify it here, I run the risk of being simplistic, a trap that I hope to avoid. The Jewish roots of the Christian faith are, well, they're unmistakable. But with the Jewish-Roman War of the late 60s and early 70s of the first century, and Judaism's vehement denial that Jesus' followers had anything to do with them, the increasingly Gentile leadership of the church began taking a stronger stand identifying the church as not just non-Jewish, but in some cases, anti-Jewish. It isn't difficult understanding why this occurred when we remember the virulent Jewish-Gentile divide that marked the world of that time. While, of course, there were individual exceptions, the rule was that Jews abhorred Gentiles, who were more than happy to return the favor. That's one of the reasons the earliest church proved difficult for outsiders to understand. It was the first movement that seemed able to bridge the divide between the two. Identities and Jews and Gentile were subsumed under a new identity as Christian. But the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD to the army of Rome, and then the catastrophe of the Bar Kokhba rebellion of the early second century, it saw the Gentile leaders of the church influenced by the anti-Jewish sentiment of the empire. In seeking to distance themselves from their Jewish roots, they de-emphasized its more Jewish elements. But really, that didn't last long. The challenge of the fiercely anti-Jewish Marcion, who you remember taught that, as he pitched him, the angry, hateful God of the Jews in the Old Testament was most certainly not the loving, blessing God of the New Testament. Well, those parts of the New Testament that Marcion accepted as inspired anyway. In refuting Marcionism, church leaders, they had to restore the faith's connection to Judaism, showing that there was absolutely no continuity between the Old and the New Testaments. On the contrary, they comprised a single corpus of holy writings normative to the Christian faith. Christianity was not a new religion, it was the fulfillment of what Judaism had laid the foundation for. It was Judaism rightly and fully realized. Well, with the connection between Judaism and Christianity settled, church leaders began dealing with the growing perception by their Gentile neighbors that Christianity was kind of a boorish faith, you know, fit only for barbarians and the uneducated. It's not difficult to understand why pagans would assume that. Christianity's central figure was, after all, crucified, a shameful death reserved only for those the empire wanted not just to get rid of, but to do so in the most ignominious way. A piece of graffiti from that time, well, it captures the way that many viewed the faith. Called the Alexamenos Graffito, it depicts the body of a man with the head of a donkey on a cross. The ancient mocking caption reads, "Alexamenos worships his God." Another factor fostering the idea that Christianity was a low-class religion was that many of the lower classes embraced it, including not a few slaves, which made up a large part of the population of the Roman world. The church was not without wealthy and privileged members, but they were a minority. And as we all know, intelligence and ability have nothing to do with social standing. So while the church membership was thin in pulling from the ranks of those at the top of society, those who rose to lead it were some of the keenest minds of the time. They knew the reasonableness of the faith and believed, if given a fair hearing, it was persuasive. So they began addressing the widespread assumption that Christianity was for illiterate, uneducated boors. They did so by finding common ground with those darlings of the Roman thought realm, the Greek philosophers of yesteryear, Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, and a host of others who'd shaped the pagan worldview. Now, one of the first to do that was Justin Martyr's most famous student, Tatian. Tatian took the most prized of Greek claims to moral and spiritual superiority and made a convincing case that the central tenets of Christianity predated the Greek discovery of them. At the same time that he pulled the philosophical rug out from under the pagan worldview, he called attention to some of its inconsistencies. For instance, how could Greeks call all non-Greek speakers barbarians when the Greeks themselves had numerous dialects that made them incomprehensible to one another? And by the way, look at all that so-called mighty Greeks had in fact learned from those barbarians. Babylonians had taught them astronomy, the Egyptians geometry, the Phoenicians writing. As for philosophy and religion, the Hebrew Moses predated Homer and Plato by hundreds of years. And to make matters worse, Tatian said the Greeks misunderstood the truths that Moses and the Hebrew prophets taught, bending them into a distortion of religion and philosophy. Greek concepts of these things were but an inferior copy of the original that Jews had preached and Christians now proclaimed. Not content to leave it at that, Tatian went after the moral character of the Greek gods and goddesses. How could deities that committed adultery, incest, and the murder of infants be worthy of worship? As icing to the cake of his takedown of the pagan pantheon, Tatian pointed out that the models that were used to make the statues the gods were worshipped by were real-life prostitutes. So while pagans accused Christians of being lower class, they are in fact worshipping people of the lower class. While the public response to Tatian's takedown was a dismissive scorn, his points hit home. Pagans from the higher classes began changing their opinions about the Christian faith, and Christian leaders in general, like Clement of Alexandria, began to explicitly draw on the ideas of the Greek philosophers in general, and Plato in particular. Well, as more and more educated pagans converted to Christianity, they wondered about the interface between their newfound faith and the Greco-Roman culture in which they lived their daily lives. A group of church leaders and teachers emerged who sought to fuse the best of Greek philosophy with the gospel, forging a kind of heroic faith. Now, during the second century, a debate ensued over this pagan-Christian fusion, a debate that in one form or another, may I say, has continued ever since. It's the debate on the relationship between revealed truth as found in Scripture and truth derived by reason, which some were quick to point out is also a gift from God. Now, most of this work was done in the Greek language, even when composed in the Latin-speaking city of Rome, because Greek was the language of scholars. The first of the church fathers to work primarily in Latin was Tertullian. Now, Tertullian was born in the North African city of Carthage about 160. Carthage had once vied with Rome for dominance of the Mediterranean, but came up on the short end of it. With its fabulous city, Carthage, leveled, and the Romans so determined to end it that they sowed its fields with salt. But its siting, where it was located, was so advantageous that it was eventually resettled as a Roman colony. It became closely connected to Rome and a main point for the departing grain ships that were bringing grain from North Africa to Rome's daily bread dole. By the mid-second century, it was a center of Roman culture with several schools boasting a first-rate education. Soon after his conversion, Tertullian began a massive output of Christian writing. A good part of those manuscripts, 31 Latin works, have survived to our time, and they make up three groups: apologetics, doctrine, and ethics. Now, sadly, none of his writings tell us anything about himself personally, his life. It's clear from the way that he wrote that he had a first-class Latin education. He was conversant in the classical tradition, which at that time was experiencing a renaissance among pagan scholars. While Tertullian was conversant in the classic tradition, he was no advocate of it. No, posing a query that's become a catchphrase of some theologians ever since. As I said earlier, he asked, "What has Athens to do with Jerusalem?" Tertullian's style and vocabulary strongly suggest he was a lawyer. His writing is often pitched as a legal treatise, though at times it becomes a polemic just dripping with sarcasm. He's regarded as one of the more important church fathers because he wrote a long list of apologetic and theological works in both Latin and Greek, the scholarly languages of both the West and the East, respectively. His Apologeticus was addressed to the Roman governor of Carthage. It refuted the slanderous charges that had been leveled against Christians, demonstrated the loyalty of Christians to the empire, to the state, and showed that persecution of Christians was foolish because they multiplied when persecuted, giving one of the more oft-quoted of his sayings, "The blood of the saints is the seed of the church." Now, though that's the popular way that it's stated, the actual quote addressed to the governor was this: We multiply whenever we are mowed down by you. The blood of Christians is seed. Now, that wasn't the only quote that went into regular circulation from Tertullian. Here are some more, and I think you'll find these rather interesting. He said, Christians are made, not born. See, they say, how these Christians love one another, for the pagans are animated by mutual hatred. How the Christians are ready even to die for one another, for the pagans themselves will sooner put to death. Truth persuades by teaching, but does not teach by persuading. Truth does not blush. Out of the frying pan, into the fire. He who flees will fight again. It is certainly no part of religion to compel religion. We worship unity in Trinity and Trinity in unity, neither confounding the person nor dividing the substance. Now that last quote zeroes in on something there. Tertullian was instrumental in helping to develop the doctrine of the Trinity or the triunity of God, as well as some of the foundational work on the nature of Christ. He helped provide a theological position that others would later draw on in the looming debates that occupied the church for generations. He's the first to use the word Trinity in speaking of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit as being three persons in one substance. Now, in a doctrine that came to be called traducianism, Tertullian said that the human soul was passed from the father and the mother to the child at conception. Because the parents were sinful, linked to Adam's fall, the soul they passed to their offspring was also fallen. That became the seed thought Augustine would later use in his development of the doctrine of original sin. Tertullian turned his pen in scathing rebuttal against infant baptism, Marcionism, the use of imperial power to persecute peaceful Christians, and those who opposed Montanism. That's right, those who opposed it. While supporting the principle of apostolic succession, Tertullian nevertheless went after the Bishop of Rome for being far too lax in upholding the moral rigor that Tertullian thought proper for the followers of Christ. Tertullian's what we might call groundbreaking work on the Trinity came in a pamphlet titled Against Praxis. Praxis represented a school of thought in the second century known as Monarchianism. It was a reaction of the emerging work of theologians like Justin Martyr, who were careful to make a distinction between the Father and Son. In doing so, Marcionists worried that they had gone too far and made Jesus into something less than God. Yet their solution didn't really help. See, Marcionism split into two modes, adoptionism and modalism. Adoptionists said that Jesus was a man, and for sure born of a virgin, but merely human. Because of his divine birth and moral perfection, at his baptism, God adopted him when the Holy Spirit descended on him, empowering him to fulfill the mission of the Messiah. Now, it's difficult to see how adoptionism satisfied the monarchian view of the unity of God when it so severely demoted the status of Jesus. And that may be why modalism became a preferred alternative. Also known as Sabellianism, after one of its chief promoters, the modalists said that God was one but appeared in different phases of redemptive history in differing modes. So until the coming of Christ, his mode was as the Father. In the incarnation, of course, he took the mode of the Son. And then from Pentecost on, he was in the Holy Spirit mode, modalism. Now, the church condemned both forms of monarchianism by the early 3rd century. But as we all know, declaring something forbidden rarely translates into it being so. Monarchian ideas didn't disappear. I mean, how could they when the church had yet to hammer out in universally accepted terms precisely what it believed about the nature of God as three in one? It was monarchian theologians who coined the word homoousios that will later be used as crucial in capturing the essence of biblical revelation about the Trinity. Now, precisely because it was a word the now banned monarchianists used, some later theologians had a hard time with it. Are you confused? Don't worry. We're going to deal with all of this in a later episode. Now, Tertullian became concerned over the way holiness was being neglected in the church. When his appeals to church leaders fell on deaf ears, he joined the growing Montanist movement. You remember, it was their aberrant views about asceticism that got them into trouble with the church. Well, their moral discipline appealed to Tertullian. In his mind, if it was a choice of staying in a spiritually lethargic and morally compromised but doctrinally right church, or joining a spirit-filled, morally excellent group that held some questionable practices, he'd rather be part of the latter and use his influence to bring them into line. His influence had been rejected by the Apostolic Church at Carthage, and so he jumped ship. Tertullian remained doctrinally orthodox until his death. His followers rejoined the church at Carthage several decades later. The what, when, and where of Tertullian's death is unknown. Jerome says that he lived to a great age, but we have no record of him after 225, making him about 65 at the time of his graduation to glory.